Without any further delay, I would like to invite our next speaker, who's Dr. Christoph Chesney. So I'll just briefly introduce you with Dr. Christoph. He's a pharmacist by training and the industrial scientist, developer of in vitro tools. Dr. Chesney is founder of well-known French companies, Bpredict and Eurosafe. Even after 20 years in his business, he is still excited by developing and providing research reagents and solutions to our worldwide industries and academic customers. Bpredict, which was formerly known as Biopredict, is very well known for their patented liver hepatocyte cells, HEPA-RG, along with liver and skin tissue product. Organization Eurosafe is well-established CRO in France. Recently, Advances Group have partnered with Bpredict and formulated a joint venture in India named Biopredict Advances Private Limited. It is indeed our lucky day to that we got a privilege to listen to Dr. Christoph, who will be talking about 3D culture system for primary hepatocytes and his patent cell line HEPA-RG. Let's welcome Dr. Christoph.
Thank you, Sachin, and good day to all the Indian friends. So it's my pleasure to share with you a few data from the company and also published data relying on our cells. So Sachin, would you please? Yeah, okay. So my talk is focused on the liver and the primary cells and the HEPA-RG, as mentioned by Sachin, and focused also on industrial applications. And at the end, I will share a few slides about possible therapeutic perspectives. So next. So next. The previous speaker has shown the complexity of the liver and the liver lobules. So this is it's an organ that is really difficult to visualize and to mimic, to reproduce in vitro, because typically in the in vivo situation, it works in a 3D setup with blood flows and bile flows. So 3D is really the way to go to improve the in vitro situation. Next. So the liver is an important target in the body, either for disease and parasitic disease or disease provoked by drugs and the environment. Next. And of course, the hepatocytes that represent approximately 70% of the mass of the liver, of the volume of the liver, are the key cells of the liver, even if more and more other cells are combined with the hepatocytes to better mimic, to have better models. Next. So in the industry, what is used today in matter of hepatocyte model? So the first model is a very basic model. This is suspension of hepatocytes. So the cells are isolated from the liver and used either fresh or after cryopreservation. And they are put in suspension in a medium. And of course, in that situation, we are far from the liver situation. But nonetheless, it's widely used today, and it represents more or less 80% of the use of the hepatocytes in the industry. They are used in suspension. For which application? For the clearance prediction. So it's very important in the drug development to predict how far, how quick the drug will be cleared in the body. So this is what is called the clearance, and the suspended hepatocytes are good enough, let's say, for that purpose. The other models are 2D, yes. And here you see HH, this is for human hepatocytes, or HepRG. This is a liver cell line. So in 2D, of course, the cells are flattened. They are more or less polarized. Human hepatocytes don't form good bile canaliculi, or if they do, it's only within a very short window of time. Gap junctions are more or less down, but not perfectly down. It remains, for the primary hepatocyte, it remains a short-term system, only a few days, 4 or 5 days, no more than that. And of course, there is no liver zonation. HepRG, it's much more robust, and the bile canaliculi are reformed. The cells can be used over 3 to 4 weeks after differentiation. And in 2D plus, so what we call 2D plus, this is what is called also the sandwich system. So sandwich system is an improvement of the 2D system. The hepatocytes are seeded on a collagen gel, and then on top of the cells that are seeded on the collagen gel, matrix gel is added. In that system, the window of time for the bile canaliculi formation is better. So you can use the hepatocytes for 2 or 3 days with functional bile canaliculi. This is also used for toxicology reasons. But more and more, the drug industry is shifting to the 3D. So these are the spheroids. Next. Sachin. I put some emphasis on the bile canaliculi because this is a key feature of the hepatocytes. So you see that the HepRG or the human hepatocytes in normal 2D, that they reform bile canaliculi. And in the sandwich systems, you see that the morphology of the bile canaliculi is improved with a sort of tubule formation. So the bile canaliculi, they connect to each other between the cells. Then, Sachin?
Yeah.
Next slide, yeah. So here you see the bile canaliculi again, with more detail. And the beauty of the 2D is in good culture conditions, such as a sandwich, the bile canaliculi will contract themselves. And it's a good system for predicting the cholestasis. So we have several papers on that topics. So the HepRG it's a good system compared to the human hepatocytes because it's obviously more robust, but also because we don't need the sandwich system to have good bile canaliculi formation. So next. So here you see the spheroids so the table summarizes the situation in terms of bile canaliculi, connexin, extracellular matrix, and a key advantage over the 2D and even 2D plus is the length of time. with which you can maintain the system. And you will see that in toxicity, for studying the toxicity, it's an important benefit, because certain toxicology readouts will show up only after repeated exposure, not after 1 day or 2 days of exposure. Next. So how to produce 3D cultures with human hepatocytes or with the EPORG? So you have basically two key options: scaffold free, and this is up to now the most preferred system in the drug industry, because it's easy to generate and it's good enough in matter of function. Of course, the limitation is that it is difficult to manipulate, and the throughput of the testing remains a bottleneck today, because even with the device that the previous speaker has shown, called Gravity Plus, it remains a low throughput technique. So this is the main limitation today. Scaffold free are good. You can increase the throughput. It's much easier to manipulate the system, but the drug industry, they don't like it so much, because they don't know how the test compound will interact with the matrix and how the test compound will penetrate into the matrix. Organ ownership, it remains relatively speculative up to now. So there are many, many groups worldwide working on that today, but throughput remains really limited. And even the maintenance of the spheroids in those systems remains relatively delicate. Next. Yeah. So here you see a spheroid in the course of formation at day three, the cells already aggregated together, but the spheroid remains relatively, it's not very structured. At day nine, the spheroid is very compact, and you can keep it during 2 or 3 more weeks with a good maintenance of the function. The cost is high, because it's human hepatocytes and they are costly. And the limitation is also high variability from one donor to another. So iPSC, availability is good, but phenotype remains relatively poor, even in 3D, and you keep more or less a fetal phenotype. You don't reach the adult full phenotype. And then FG2 is still today widely used, even if everyone recognize that it's a very limited system in terms of phenotype. It's a fetal phenotype with a completely disrupted karyotype, and many hepatic functions are missing. But of course, it's relatively robust and cheap. And EPORG is a good compromise, because you have the hepatic functions, you have the adult phenotype, and it's cheaper and more robust than with human hepatocytes. And with EPORG, the formation of the spheroid is really straightforward. So in matter of matrix and medium, next. I just mentioned a few ones. You have many, many. So there are so many papers about that. So I just mentioned a few that are, let's say, a little more popular than others. But again, you know, it's a good system for addressing academic questions. It's, to my knowledge, very little used today in the drug industry for the limitations I mentioned before in matter of interaction with the test compounds and penetration into the matrix. Next. And you have I selected that slide from a partner in France. So they produce, they embed the EPORG cells into alginate beads. So it's a relatively old technique. But you will see at the end of the talk that they are using that system for the bioartificial liver, and they have promising data in matter of transplantation to the nude mouse. So eventually, it's a solution in terms of using the EPORG for certain therapeutic needs. It's an easy technique. Okay. Then, yeah. So I will come back to the limits. So one of the limitation of the spheroid is that you can have only one spheroid per well. Why? Because if you put two, they will merge. And if they merge, you will increase the size of the small tissue, and you will create anoxia. Of course, hepatocytes and EPORG, they consume a lot of oxygen. They consume so much compared to other cell types. And anoxia will appear as soon as you go over 100 micron diameter. So one spheroid per well means that you need very sensitive analytical techniques for your readouts. So another limit then is as mentioned by the previous speaker, imaging is difficult. So nowadays you have that 3D technique promoted by Greiner. So it's a magnetic technique with which you can fix the spheroid at the bottom of the well, and of course for imaging, it's a big plus because you are sure that your system will be in the focus of the microscope. So it's next slide. So you have several papers describing that. Another limitation, as mentioned before, is the penetration of the antibodies. And here you see with two antibodies that don't penetrate into the spheroid. They remain at the surface of the spheroid. They are supposed to reach intraspheroid targets, but it does not work. So this is a big limitation in terms of immunostaining. So what is left then in matter of readout? You can use RNA sequencing and NGS. You can use proteomic analysis of the secretome or the intracellular proteome and mRNA by PCR and so on. And of course, mass spec, if your analyte is sensitive enough in the mass spec. But many classical techniques classically used in 2D cannot be used in 3D. And that's one of the limitations that the users face when they switch, when they try to switch their assay from a 2D setup to a 3D setup. Next. So applications. So here, the paper of Bell is of interest because he tested a compound that is called fialuridine that revealed itself in the clinical trials in the humans as very hepatotoxic. And you see that if you apply the compound during 2 days with the hepatocytes, you don't find any toxicity in matter of viability. Whereas if you go further in terms of exposure to 7 days or 4 weeks, you will find the compound very hepatotoxic. And this is a relatively classical scenario. So here I put another slide from in a 2D, in a classical 2D, and you see that this is a compound that is toxic on the mitochondrial replication. It's a slow effect. The effect will appear slowly after 1 week, 2 weeks, and so on. So to have that possibility of repeated long-term exposure, you need to maintain your system long enough in vitro. And here again, 2D does not work because your human hepatocytes or rat hepatocytes, they survive only a few days in vitro. So this is really a key benefit of the spheroid system here. Next. So here, this is 2D, but again, just to emphasize again that so with troglitazone, you have the same effect. Toxicity will show up only after a few days of exposure. So you cannot do that in 2D with human hepatocytes, whereas it becomes feasible with the heparg because you can keep them during several weeks after differentiation. And here, this is a comparison between primary hepatocytes, heparg, and iPS-derived hepatocytes for 3 drugs, acetaminophen, aflatoxin B1, it's a pollutant that is very hepatotoxic, and amiodarone, another drug that is toxic by several pathways, toxic pathways in matter of steatosis and mitochondrial toxicity. So here you see that you have that effect of long-term exposure with acetaminophen, especially, and aflatoxin B1, but less with amiodarone. You have that on the primary hepatocyte and heparg. With iPS hepatocytes, as said before, their functions, certain of their hepatic functions remain limited, and you see that they don't respond to acetaminophen toxicity, even after several exposures, because simply they have not enough P450s to produce the toxic metabolites. When you use your liver systems, you should know this sort of limitation to in order to choose the right system to make your screening and to test your compounds. So here, this is with EPAR-G. So this is classical histology of the EPAR-G spheroid. So with HE, so classical staining, pass, this is for glycogen, and SUEFOR with a high expression of the P450, and CK19 that is more expressed on the surface, because on the surface you have the cholangiocytes, EPAR-G cells. It's a co-culture system with hepatocytes and sort of cholangiocytes, immature cholangiocytes. And MRP2, that is a drug transporter expressed at the bile canaliculi, and that is well expressed all over the spheroid. So here I show the data produced by Steve Ferguson at the EPA in America, and he's a big fan of the spheroids, and especially with the EPAR-G. So here, what you see is that he compared human hepatocytes in suspension, so more or less this is the capacities of the liver itself in vivo, because the cells are used only a few hours after isolation. And then you see primary hepatocytes in red, EPAR-G cells in 2D, and EPAR-G cells in 3D. So you see that for the 1 and 2, you have a big loss of P450, either with the primary hepatocytes in 2D or even in the EPAR-G cells in 2D. It's a little higher and little better in 3D. For the 2B6, clearly you see that EPAR-G in 3D do a good job compared to the other in vitro systems and compared to the in vivo situation. And it's still better in for the 3F4, where more or less in 3D, so with the EPAR-G in spheroid, you recover the initial level of the liver. And in that paper, he also described how the EPAR-G in 3D is a good system for studying the P450 induction. Here, another paper from that team of Steve Ferguson in America, where he studied EPAR-G in the spheroid mode of culture to predict cholestasis. And you see the control. So here he used a dye that very easily and very conveniently stain the bile canaliculi, reformed in the spheroid. So on the top, you have the control, and then you have cyclosporine A and bosentan. The two drugs are cholestatic drugs, and you see that they inhibit the efflux of the fluorescent dye towards the bile canaliculi. So you have less fluorescence in the system because of that toxicity. Next. So here, this is more related to DMPK. So as mentioned before, in the drug industry, it's a very routine application to measure the clearance of a new drug. So here, this is a recent paper from AstraZeneca, where they measure the clearance of different drugs using different human hepatocyte batches. So you see that there is a relatively large variation from batch to batch, and this is expected. This reflects the variation that we have in the human population. But what also is of interest is that they were able to measure the clearance of very slow clearance compounds. Classically, with suspended hepatocytes, you can measure clearance of drugs that are medium cleared compounds and highly cleared compounds. But for slow clearance compounds, and many modern drugs are very slowly cleared from the body because they are ingested at very low level. So you take only 1 milligram of compound to treat the disease. So as a result, you have only nanomolar of drugs in the body. And to keep a good pharmacokinetics, you need the drug to be very slowly cleared from the body. And clearance is very, the clearance of these drugs is difficult to measure in vitro. It's a matter of sensitivity. And here, with the spheroid system, they show that they're able to measure properly the clearance of these very slowly cleared drugs. And it's a big improvement. Next. So here, I come back to the 2D to show that EPORG clearance data are completely similar to human hepatocyte data. So it has been shown in 2D a few years ago, and it's true also in 3D. So for measuring clearance of your drugs, you can use for medium clearance and quick clearance drugs, you can use 2D, but for slow clearance drugs, you can use either human hepatocyte spheroid or EPORG spheroids. Then, so something completely different, it's about infectious disease. And here, these are recent data, not published yet. So that's why I cannot share so much about what is measured. But here, this is the sporozoite of the mosquito that is GMO. So the mosquito produce GFP positive sporozoite. And you see that one day after exposure of the human hepatocyte spheroid with a parasite, you have labeling inside the spheroid, and still more after 2 days. Next. And you see that the volume of the parasite inside the spheroid is growing quickly between 1 day and 2 days. That is a sign that the parasite is installing himself into the spheroid. And you see the same in terms of specific DNA probes related to the parasite. Then, and the good thing with the system is that Primakine, that is a Primakine, that is a classical anti-malarial drug, was shown to exhibit its effect, and you cannot do that at all with the 2D hepatocyte because, again, the life of the hepatocyte in vitro is too short, so you cannot infect properly your system with the parasite and then apply your drug within that short life of the human hepatocyte in 2D. Only the 3D is able to allow you to do that. Then, okay. And then perspectives. So this is, I have less knowledge about that that application. This is not the topic in the company, but we work with many groups worldwide. And we work, for example, with a group in Korea. And they do printing of the EPORG, with the FRG, and they do special spheroids with that printing technique with the FRG. Then, and you see, compared to the primary hepatocyte in on the left, you see that in classical 3D, the FRG do well for certain markers, but there, so this is in their hands. We do much better in our hands, but in their hands, they claim that they do much better with the printed FRG aggregated, let's say, together with that with their printing technology. And then they use these small spheroids, printed spheroids, into a nude mouse where that is defective in its liver function. And here they show that when they inject this human FRG spheroid into this mouse, they improve the survival of the mouse quite significantly compared to the non-engrafted mouse. They show also in their paper that the spheroid will be become vascularized with the vasculature of the mouse. And they were able to detect significant level of human albumin secreted by the FRG spheroid in the blood of their mouse. So it gives some hope that these spheroid techniques can be useful for further therapeutic application. And then, so as a conclusion, hepatic spheroid system can be used to predict the toxicity of the compounds, to measure clearance of the compounds, and can be useful also for studying certain complex parasitic diseases. And then eventually can be used for in vivo application for transplantation to laboratory animals, and eventually later for certain clinical applications. I thank you for your attention.
Thank you. Thank you, Dr. Christoph. It was really an informative presentation. Till now, I was aware that HPARG can be used in different culture conditions, and we can use it for mainly for a toxicity purpose. But the way the last portion where you have explained the parasite interaction with HPARG and the disease progression with the malaria and all, that was something really new with respect to HPARG. It was really a nice presentation. I hope everybody must have understood what is the difference between 2D and 3D, how we can have a 2D culture with respect to human liver from we can have a primary hepatocytes, and then we have a cell lines, and how HPARG is different from all these things, even though we have a stem cells. To that matter, a very recent iPSCs, how iPSCs also cannot serve the purpose what organoids or for that matter HPARG can do in case of liver.